Nobody. Hello.
Hello.
All right, just trying to get settled here. So
Oh,
yeah,
you're back.
thank you for your email about the event, and so you understand why I don't make it too public, right?
Got it. And you're back now? You're back from Malta?
And no, I'm in Sicily.
Oh yeah. Oh, you're still in Sicily. Yeah, you would go after Sicily. Yeah, okay.
Today we went to Mount Etna.
Oh, the Vulcan, the volcanic.
Yes, have you been?
Yes, I have seen it from a distance, but I haven't really been up there.
Yeah, we drove up and we were at the base station. Then we took a kind of a gondola a little further up. So it was good. I got to do some art video stuff, and yeah, it was
Nice.
worthwhile having had a look.
Great.
That was Oh, wow. Okay. I'm not
So
sure who's
you,
joining us today.
Any word from Fabien?
Oh, from who?
From Fabien, our French friend. Fabien.
Oh, Fabian. Oh, sorry. Yeah, he's been replying to some emails. I guess he's still half on holiday.
Okay.
So I don't know exactly what's happening. It would be good to see him today. I did ask him if he was planning to, but I don't know. Don't know quite yet, but we'll give him another few minutes. Ega mama, bye. Second. Ega, come say hi to Leon.
Hello.
Hello. Edgar is right.
Yeah, he's going swimming now. Sorry, the lens is a bit.
Oh, nice.
Yeah,
Sounds
it's
great.
32 degrees here.
Oh, yeah, that's a good time to swim or a good temperature.
Exactly. Mount Etna was okay. It was 22.
Okay. Yeah, here it's 37 degrees in Hungary. It's quite hot, to be honest.
37 in Hungary. I didn't even know you were in Hungary, but 37, that's yes. Let me see if I
Yeah,
can.
and
What
like
city are you in?
we have air conditioning and stuff, but we just had a small power outage, and I could definitely feel the difference.
Yeah. Are you in Budapest?
Yes, correct.
Is that where you normally live now?
These days, yes, that's my home base these days.
Excellent. I've never been, but I've had friends stay and say it's just a fantastic place.
I'm still happy with it. Yeah.
What district are you in?
Well, there's a Hero Square, and to be honest, I forgot the district, but I'm basically where the Hero Square is. It's a famous tourist place.
I have no idea what that means.
I will send a picture later in it looks quite nice. Very
Yeah.
classical.
Is it close to the river then?
Also, yes. Yeah.
Margaret Island, I'm seeing here.
Yeah, correct.
It's quite crazy. We were sitting, Edgar and us, we were having a nice dinner yesterday. Well, no, dinner turned out to be not so good. But anyway, we're having some ice cream later and playing Uno. Fantastic. And then he's learning geography by where we've been. So we have
Ah, okay.
globes and maps, but of course the map on our phone he can use. And then I checked
Aha.
the map on the Apple Watch, and it has the whole world in it. It's the normal Apple Watch, the map's just small. It's just
And
astounding.
it works well.
Yeah, it works.
Oh, wow.
You can zoom in and out of the whole world. I mean, it's inconvenient because of the size of the screen. But it's got the detail and it's smooth and yeah, it's crazy.
That's impressive because I remember a time where Google Maps was nearly crashing your laptop.
Yeah, good
It
point.
was a very heavy application.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, no, that's that. So, yeah. So you think it is relatively likely that you can make it?
Yes. Right now I'm yeah. I'm really working hard to finish the text up front, and I'm trying to, now that you gave me the location, I will find a place nearby to stay.
How
I
well
think
do
it
you know
will be a
London?
cool. So not so well. Zero knowledge.
Oh, okay. Well, the thing about London is you don't have to worry about where you stay, because the public transport is really good. So anywhere is a reasonable distance. We live in Wimbledon,
Oh.
which takes about an hour to get into town, but it's all very reliable, so it's never an issue. So you
Oh,
just look for
nice.
something that's you think looks nice and affordable, and on the tube map, it's fine. And here
So I
it's
don't have to be 15 minutes of walk from the place. I can. Okay, that's good to know. Yeah.
yeah,
Yeah,
absolutely.
try to get a transit pass for while you're going to be there so that you can have unlimited use of the tube.
No, actually, Peter, you don't need it anymore. You can just use a debit or credit card. And
Oh,
it
wow, because when I went, they had the, well, that was back in
Oyster
89.
card. Oyster card. Yeah, no,
I
that.
absolutely loved it though.
I mean, now it even is so good as to allow you to take the train on the same thing. So, for instance, when we go to the airport, I just tap with the credit card on my watch and it does the whole thing. It's really very well done.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah, no, London
But
is
you
different.
tap and then you confirm on the watch or?
No, for transport, you don't even need to confirm. You just tap and go.
Wow.
And they've introduced just now ultra low emission zone for all of London, not just the center of London. So if cars that pollute want to be there, they have to pay more money every day. It's interesting because in Shanghai, the entire city is now electric cars only. They made it so expensive to come in with a petrol vehicle that basically people can't afford to do it. It's kind of
The
interesting.
trouble is that just shifts the pollution somewhere else. Still have to generate the power to charge the batteries. And a lot of that, at least here in the States, it's coming from coal plants since they just shut down my nice clean nuclear plant. It was in my area. So now we're on dirty sources of energy to replace the clean nuclear energy because they're afraid of the nuclear waste 100,000 years from now.
I happen to agree with you on nuclear energy completely. Hello, Fabian.
Eduardo.
I see your t-shirt. You've been having lazy days for a while. That's good.
Indeed,
But you're
but I still
back.
want more.
Oh no. Well, how was your holiday?
Lovely, but too short. It's
Yes.
nice. It's also a moment to experiment, to try new things, like going on about being offline, or well, now I went from a online to offline to now I allow myself to for example, if I'm in a museum and there is a QR code, then this I can check. But it has to be like 100% contextual. It cannot be unrelated to the place and the moment. And that worked out pretty well. I enjoyed it.
That sounds good. Good. Yeah, I'm in Sicily right now. We spent some time in Malta and we're here so we can take the train tomorrow evening to Rome, take the train including on a boat, which is so cool. So then I'll be there for the Hypertext conference. I'm guessing none of you are going, or are you, or attending remotely or anything?
Oh, how does it work for remote attendance? I did not even consider it.
I will have a look right now. No, that's the wrong. Okay, Hypertext 2023. I'm just trying to find a proper link. I found the boring link. That's weird. Yeah, here we go. I'll share it on the group. Obviously, I would enjoy it more if you were there. So attending, okay, and it's supposed to be hybrid. Yeah, maybe it's not that hybrid. I know that the human side is definitely that's the workshop on Monday. That's where they want me to present. Also, just to take the pulse, I know Leon is trying to come to London for the future of tech. How about Peter and Fabienne? Are you thinking of coming?
I'll just be operating remotely. Really, with elder care, I can't afford to do any long-range travel.
Yeah, that's of course unfortunately understandable. By the way, it's the 4th and 5th of October. The 4th will be the full event. The 5th we'll have to figure out what to do. I'm sure we'll think of something. Fabienne will hop on the train.
I'm pretty sure I'll manage. I think that I had some like family conflict or another event, but it's a different date, so I'll let's say I'm 90% sure.
Good. That's 90% good. Okay, as I emailed, is it okay if I spend some minutes running through the hypertext presentation to see what you guys think? Okay, thanks. Will do. Mark Anderson not join us today. I'm not sure about Brendel or anyone else, but because I'm making you guys small so I can see the text, if someone else joins, can you please tell me? Okay, thanks. You can obviously see the screen, right?
Yes.
Yep.
Great. So this is intended to be a relatively short presentation leading up to dialogue. So the paper in the title is Where Are We With This? And with this, I mean VR. Oh, hang on. Fabienne is just on the top of that text. I'm going to move you guys there. Okay. So I mean interactions with knowledge in VR. And VR, I mean VR, AR, all these things. It's fully immersive environments we're talking about. I'm not saying that we're going to be working in VR all day, but if we get it right, we can think of these things as thinking caps. If we carefully build the tools, infrastructures, and maybe most importantly, people's expectations of what this can be. By the way, guys, there are some transitions here. I know that doesn't work well over Zoom, but this will be a live presentation. So if it looks a bit funny, that's the way it is. Sorry. So one of the questions is, will VR constrain us or free us? I'm not here with answers. I'm hoping we can come up with better questions together. This really is a call to arms to think about thought in multiple dimensions of freedom. So what happens when we no longer need a substrate, a medium for interaction? That's the end goal of HCI, right? The invisible interface. Impossible? Yes, of course it is. But what happens when the substrate almost disappears? Do interactions get easier? No, not necessarily.
Sorry, do we do comments live or do you prefer at the end? Because I
No,
don't
no,
know
no.
if.
If you have something now, absolutely
Okay.
interrupt.
So then, for the can you come back to the previous slide? About the end goal of HCI as being yes. So for this one, for the yes, this one. So my initial reaction to this was, is it really the angle of HCI? And I imagine I have two camps, people who say like, oh yeah, why not? And others like, absolutely not. And then I thought of like the infamous like Minority Report scene where like he's in the air and he's doing like the study of who is the bad guy or whatnot. First it comes back all the time, including with professionals, like at the parliament, that's like a reference basically. And then I think last week a colleague mentioned the Gal Gadot recent horrible movie according to ratings, like 5.10 or 0.7 out of 10 on IMDb. And even yesterday, I saw, or was it for lunch? I watched Foundations, the Asimov as a TV series. Yeah, I really enjoy it. And there is yet another scene where I think the spacers, I'm not spoiling anything, but there are some beings that also, like, you see them drawing in the air. And I think a lot of, like, the mathematics, there is a recurring theme on it, is done with, like, moving things in the air. So I would maybe here consider a slide with, like, five of those examples to say, okay, I don't know if it's, like, the end goal, but at least in terms of the imagination of a lot of people, it is, yeah, what people see, imagine the future. I don't know if it's right in the sense that it triggered me a little bit to say, is it the end goal? But at least in terms of the imagination of most people, we see it like really all the time. So maybe a couple of visual there to say, okay, it might not be the objective end goal, but yeah, it's something that at the very least crystallized the imagination of most.
Yeah, I'm about to contradict that statement there, but I do think it's absolutely fine to have this in.
Can you drop the URL for that in the chat?
What's that?
Can you drop the URL for that video clip in the chat?
Oh, I just searched for Minority Report in YouTube. I will do that. I can try. Hang on. Boom, there it is. So, yeah, I obviously this is something I can waste your time fiddling forever, so I won't do that. I'll just make it slightly something there. Okay, yeah, that's a fair point. Thank you for those examples and ideas. I may mention what's in the background. So this is, of course, impossible. But as Fabian, you were referring to, what happens when the substrate almost disappears? Do interactions get easier? I would say no, not necessarily. If you look at things like dancing, sports, activities with very little interaction with anything other than our own bodies, these are all high effort, high training activities. They're not necessarily easier. So the less interface, the easier it is. That's a bit wrong. However, with VR, this is where we're going, potentially. And then we have to ask questions like this. And at the end, I will list all the questions and then will be available in a Google Doc for us to work on, I will tell them. When we can reinvent tools in this entirely new environment, which tools will be useful, and how will we define tool? These are questions we need to ask in conjunction with what kind of environment we want to work in, since it's all synthetic. What environment will we be working in? Early VR was fully immersive. However, Apple has introduced spatial computing, where you are in default in AR and you have windows, volumes, and spaces. So is this how we want to work? If we can't answer the question, if we want to work like this, we don't really have the right to complain about whether this is the right way to go or not. So here's the thing. Is this a necessary step in training wheels for VR? Or is it simply retarding deeper dreaming of what VR can be? See, the little Apple Vision woman now has become like a person. I hold human imagination to be one of the most powerful faculties we possess, something to be cherished and nurtured, not to be put into boxes. How else can we navigate to a better future if we cannot dream it? Opportunities are wide open. Let us not prematurely constrain them. Let us proactively dream of powerfully interactive knowledge worlds. These images were all created by generative AI based on the Apple Vision person illustration. I prefer dragons to boxes. Will AI multiplied by VR be more powerful than our imagination? That is an entirely different and new dimension that I'm not going to get into too much today. But we can look at things like we cannot easily separate environment from tool anymore, information from tool, or information from interaction anymore. So, text and VR? Yes, absolutely. Text in VR is symbol manipulation at scale. Symbol manipulation, encoded language thought with grammar at scale VR. So here's a more concrete thing. I open a document in VR. I look at an uncomfortable place. Then I gesture to move graphs and pictures out to go to different walls. So then we can ask questions like, what is a wall? Is it something defined as a rectangle? Or semantically, can I call a wall my graphs wall and another my pictures wall? So when I go to different locations, these will be in expected places. What software owns it? Yeah, Fabian, go ahead. Raise hand, by the way. Please just feel free to interrupt all of you.
Yeah, I find that it's a tricky switch, and I don't know how. But to go from dragons to a blackboard, it's like the dream got crushed in between two slides.
I hate you.
I'm sorry.
Who here played Dungeons and Dragons? Be honest.
So I've been. So is that going to? That's going to take more than a minute to answer. Sorry again. But
don't be sorry. I'm so grateful for you guys helping with this.
So I have my little. I'm sharing on my screen, and Leon, we cannot hear you. I have like the Steam Deck, which is a console. I mean, it's a desktop computer in a console format, which I brought on a holiday on the beautiful island of Capraia in Italy, because I was hooked on Baldur's Gate 3, which is based on Dungeon and Dragon, but as a video game. And I spent a couple more hours even today playing it. So yeah, it's a video game though. It's not like with a dungeon master sitting at the table, but I'm quite hooked on that thing.
I think that's really cool. Really, really cool, because I used to play Dungeons and Dragons back in the day when everything was analog, of course. And I remember being very young and being in the car with my mother when she picked me up and saying and retelling what happened as though it was real, not things on a plate. And, you know, it's like, I cannot believe we were going around this corner, Mom, etc. So now I hope soon when Edgar's at the right age, he will play it, because it's not just presented. So you're saying something really, really important. When you play Dungeons and Dragons, it is a symbol manipulation. You know, these things, whether it's at whatever level of representation, they are symbolic of richer creatures, richer environments, all of that stuff. So what I think of...
Note also, by the way, is when I don't know if I can easily show you, but I have the game there. But it's just ridiculously complex. Like, it's so rich. I'm like 45 hours of gameplay. It's supposed to be like 100 plus hours to finish it. And I think I'm barely at 20%. So that's going to take me about forever, but it's worth it. My point being that, it doesn't boot anymore, but that's okay. I take notes. Like, when it starts to be too complicated on the console itself, on the Steam Deck, there's an app for each game where you can like just take notes, say, oh, in this dungeon, you need to find that thing or that, because it just become too much. So there is a bit of knowledge management in it, which is one, you can annotate the map, like place a marker on the map to say, too hard, come back later, or this item needed or whatnot. And just plain text note where you type a bit of text to say, okay, this, I receive this comment from that persona and you need to go back with this. So there is also knowledge management in video games when the depth is so huge that you need some way, some tools basically to cope with it. So there is some kind of link in there between documents and dragons.
Yeah, I think there is. And I think we should have a session on games soon. Not gamification, but games for exactly the reasons you said. So with Edgar, I'm now, he's learning a little bit of geography because we're in Sicily and we're taking the train to Rome. I want to take the train so he learns there is a lot, not just jumping like dots, there's a connection. And as I was talking to Leon earlier, We don't have to get him a special map. He's got the entire world on both his parents' iPhones. And then it turns, I have the same thing on my watch. The reason I'm mentioning it is he's also learning a little bit of history. History, in a sense, is a game. It's a story. So the way that we interact with the fake world or the real world, of course, have serious analogies, differences. And I think you're absolutely right. It can inform knowledge work decisions. Right, so I've changed this because I've added, so we go from Dungeons and Dragons to Documents and Dragons. Whoops, why did that go so quickly? That's not supposed to go automatic. Oops, click. Right, okay. We go from Dungeons and Dragons to Documents and Dragons and Documents and Knowledge Interaction. It may sound a little bit boring, but in order to get to the rich worlds, we have to understand how to deal with the models we have today, right? Fair enough. Yes, huge agreement. Excellent. Okay. So now I'm just throwing out a series of questions to help the audience understand the kind of questions we have been asking for the last year and a half, 2 years, such as where are these things and what is a space and how we move between them. At this point, I'm just throwing them out. It's for later to discuss them. How do we transfer information? What can be seen, interacted with, and taken when you're in a shared space? Where is something in VR and where is it in relation to what? So the graph. Graphs without text are just not all that useful. So it is amazing to have the opportunity to have a knowledge graph in VR. You can think in room scale. However, it gets really, really messy very quickly. The key to is selection control and view control. Control is the ability to act, react, connect, and undo. That's a bit arbitrary, but hopefully it'll wake people up in the room who might disagree with some of that. So a brief illustration from my own software, the map view in Author, where I will first define a concept and then use group selections to organize. So I select JSON, I choose define concept, write what I think it is. I say that this is an infrastructure, click at the bottom of the screen to go to the map view, and there it is. So here I can move anything freeform as I want to. But if I select a category, such as here, metadata, as in if I hide and then bring back, they're all selected. That means I can do normal keyboard shortcuts to align things like you can in a word processor. By the way, guys, I hope to have a control click menu for this because it's easy for me once I know it, but to show someone and to teach a new user, it's a bit messy. But all I'll be showing here really is the importance of being able to select things based on groups.
One thing I enjoy when there are tutorials online is when the key that are pressed, let's say shortcuts, are shown on the screen. Because otherwise, when you're not doing it, maybe you're pressing one key, five keys, whatnot. I don't know. And you can comment it, but it's not the same as visually seeing the keys pressed.
I hope not to have to do that. That's what I mean by the control click menu. I hope that by the presentation, Jacob has made it so I can control click and then you can see the options.
Right, but I'm saying even pressing the control key, having like a little control button displayed on the side, when I see streamers or people doing tutorials, I found that very helpful.
Yeah, but isn't that right click or left click or whatever in Windows or Unix? Or isn't that like... Okay, fair enough. I get your point. But
the crazy thing is, I was just about to make the exact same comment that Fabian was making when he made it.
That you'd like to see the keys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's sort of like ghosted at, you know, maybe 30% capacity only, just to appear in the upper corner of the screen. Feedback might be picked up by videos. It'd be really good.
I can absolutely do that if... Jacob doesn't add the ability for me to click on something and get a visual menu, then I think I absolutely have to do that. Leon?
I would say it's a nice to have, not a must have, because a context menu is so universally known to people. So I think if all the actions are visible through the context menu, then yeah, the keys are nice to have, but I don't think it's necessary to understand what's going on.
The in the context menu, which, so this is, of course, the kind of menu we're talking about. Uniquely here, it does say what the keyboard shortcuts are. So for instance, for define concept, it has command D. So, you know, people will learn it over time. But I don't have this context menu in the map view, as I mentioned. So we'll see. But anyway, what I wanted to show with this slide was the importance of being able to select based on different criteria and to organize. And then we know, okay, I should call it context menu, shouldn't I? And this is where I'm also asking you, Fabienne, because you have made that really cool kind of wrist menu. Do you have a screenshot of that in use?
I've that somewhere on Twitter, at least something like a GIF, and then you can snap it. I mean, you can take a frame out of it.
Okay. I'll go.
It's something I want to explore a lot more. I think I don't know what prompted it, but I'm going to dig deeper into this because the same way there is like the feedback when you tap on your wrist to get shortcuts, it gives you some haptic feedback. I think the using the five fingers to pick and drop document. I'll look it up if you want because it's a bit. I don't know how old it is. Ah, yeah, that's also maybe that could work. A bit messy, but. There is another one with just a document if you want.
Yeah, no, but this is perfect. This because this is not what I was talking about. This is a different kind. I was hoping Brendel would be here today because it would be interesting to have his perspective since I am partly talking about the Apple way.
And a quick comment also while you search through. I'm now more curious also to this could be also an example. It's more on individual keystrokes, but what's the name? The Vision Pro, I'm quite curious to physically test it because when I try, for example, the idea for shortcuts on single fingers, the precision of the Quest Pro is meh. It starts to show its limits, basically. I imagine the next one or the Quest 3 or the Vision Pro will be radically better. But I think when you start to go quite fast and precise with the hand motion, you basically need another way to do tracking. But yeah, I think there is a lot more to explore, including for documents, typing, shortcuts, all that with just the hands and fingers.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's very important knowledge because that can also decide the lowest common denominator between all kinds of hand tracking devices, because at some point, you want to have some kind of standard way of doing things.
Yeah, no, exactly. That's the second bit here below. When is it going to be standardized and how long will it be open and how long should it be wild? Yeah, Peter.
I saw an interesting blurb in my news feed this morning that supposedly Apple is going to have something called a ghost stone or something along those lines. And it sounded like it was supposed to be an accessory for the Vision Pro that reminded me of the pick and drop user interfaces that were demonstrated at Kai back in the 90s. So I'm guessing what it's going to be is something that you can hold in your hand that the system will be able to attach a unique ID to so that in the VR environment, you'll be able to grab some data object and stick it in your hand with the rock. And then after you go offline, take that rock to another location, another Vision Pro, hand the rock to someone else, and the system will somehow be able to pick up the ID of the rock, then link out to the massive data blob on the network and pull it in to remanifest it at the new location. At least that's what the rumors sort of seem to be hinting at my best guesstimate.
That's interesting.
Sounds a bit like a social copy paste.
Yep.
Fabien, where's your hand with the box cube?
I don't know if you skipped it. I think maybe the one you were manipulating, the last one you looked at maybe was the closest. No, before this, the documents. There were one with cubes. I don't remember cubes.
Actually, this is fine for now. So just two examples of menus. And so you see, it's a very short presentation. So in closing, a goal for VR. For me, the goal for VR is to create an environment where my brain can breathe. And this is actually a notion that I realized when thinking of you guys in the Monday group, of how sometimes it's frustrating, sometimes it's difficult being with you guys, but I can breathe here. My brain, my skull feels bigger. I don't feel smarter, but I feel that the people in the room extend my thoughts in ways, you know, sometimes agreeing, sometimes going in different tangents. So I think that when we're looking really for what incredible environments can do, they should try to strive to be close to what you guys have managed to do. And, you know, VR extends our potential. How we choose to extend ourselves defines who we are and who we want to be. Obviously, this is a VR AI, excuse me, AI generative rendering trying to be my son, Edgar. Here he is for real. So how we define these interactions in VR now will determine interactions for generations, just like PC interactions became standardized into word processing, email, web spreadsheets, and not much more. And of course, I'll mention to the group, this is my son, Edgar, whose intellectual future I'm fighting for. This is not abstract for me.
Two quick notes. If you have a photo of Edgar with the headset, and ideally with what he's doing in it, I would also consider adding it, in the sense that otherwise it feels a little bit not too emotional, but maybe not pragmatic enough. It's like, are you really willing to do the experiment? Where that, if there is the headset, it shows you have like skin in the game, not just for the photo of a child, all emotional. I don't know. I would consider this. And one quick thing also, like a bit of a promotion, let's say at some point, maybe a year ago, I did a quick demo, or prototype rather, where you had the tiles. You load a 3D model and then you have like a dozen tiles, and you can basically use this for Dungeon and Dragon, or to set up, to do game level design in a game, so that you pick a tile, and instead of being, let's say, a chessboard, it's a 3D model of what the space will be. And that could be, let's say, maybe easier transition for the Documents and Dragons or Dungeons and Dragons, because it has a kind of like fancy theme, and I can look it up if you want.
Yeah, I think I have a picture here. Could you repeat again what you did a year ago? I didn't fully grasp that.
Yeah, I'll look it up. But I have at some point, because one of my problem was, yeah, I manipulate text more than 3D models. But in the end, if you want to be in a space in VR, you can design the 3D model or just load an existing one. So I made a quick prototype where you load up, they're called asset kits, where you have 50 different 3D models, but they are, let's say, on a single theme, for example, a roller coaster or or fantasy or space or whatnot. And then you have like the tiles in front of you, and then you can move them and assemble them to make the world in front of you. So I'll look that up, because one of them had I think this one, I would say, had the right theme. So it would help maybe to bridge between Dungeons and Dragons and Documents. I don't know if it's, maybe it's too abstract. But basically, yeah, you can manipulate tiles, not just document. So maybe that could help.
If you want to send that, yeah, I'd be happy to look at putting it in for sure.
I put it in the chat.
Okay. I'm just wondering if there's an Edgar one. But beyond this, are there any Any comments? I'll try to do Edgar headset, of course. Comments or questions?
I have one. At some point, you had a couple of slides about the separation between text and interaction. Do you remember?
Yeah.
And my feeling was that either it needs a sort of example picture, or it needs to go a bit slower, because I really liked this. It was quite a deep, a deep statement. So, and it went a bit fast to a different topic, almost.
Okay, let's go
because
back.
You were kind of hinting at some kind of diffusion process, and at some point I kind of like got lost in these examples or in these phrases, and I didn't know anymore what you meant by it, by these separations.
By the way, Fabian, before I go into Leon's more important thing than the picture of Edgar, do you think I should go from this to this, or do you think I should have that at the end, the headset?
But is it Edgar?
This is Edgar.
Yeah. So the problem now is we don't. if there were not hints around like you, then we don't know it, Edgar. So maybe this one.
I'll play around with that later, because like this is really cool. I love this image because she is literally screaming. But look how weird the rendering errors around her nose and stuff.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Pretty horrible,
yeah.
Right?
It's creepy.
Yeah, it's really creepy. But it was very useful going through this process. I haven't done that much Midjourney, but it really shows that it only knows what it's been taught. So, for instance, when I wanted images of only dragons, it would usually put a girl in a bikini in there. It's obviously been trained on fantasy arts. So to try to do the prompts right, you're really fighting the training set. And so that was really interesting to learn how constrained it is. Right. So are you talking about this?
Yeah, these slides. I after the second we cannot, I already lost how we got there. Like, the what was the introduction to get into these separations or separations?
Yeah, I'm going to. There is this one, because what happens here, I kind of acknowledge the AI stuff, the imagery, right? And then I want to go to just say, this is something else. So this is the new one here. So let's just maybe give it a title, maybe something.
Yeah, maybe different, or because yeah, that's what I kind of forgot. This that it's entirely different and new dimension. Yeah. What is this we see in VR? Yeah.
Because one of the great things about what I've seen Fabian do is, you see there's a cube on your arm. Is that just a visual thing? Is that a new function? What is it we see in VR? I guess these are the questions, right?
And overall, I really like it. Small phrases, big fonts. I love it.
Thank you very much. So let's do this transition. So la la la, that's something entirely different. So what is it we see in VR? And thank you, Leon, for helping stress that point. So we cannot easily separate environment from tool anymore. What are the affordances and what are the expected affordances? Should I maybe put that at the end? So start like this.
I'm wondering also for, like, I don't know the audience, but I don't know if they're not, like, experienced with the medium, if they're going to get it, in the sense that in VR, the environment is everything you see. Literally, like, that's the whole point of the medium. And indeed, what you see, what you don't see, also is fundamental. Like, is the world editable? Can you change some assets or the code or everything? And how do you do this? Because otherwise, you're on your desktop and then you look at stuff, but you can pull out your phone. I mean, it's a radically different way to consume or create content. So it's indeed a core question. But I'm wondering how somebody who is not used to it would perceive the depth of it, or would understand why it's so important as a question.
Yeah, that's a good point. I've been spending some time with Ismail and Vint on these issues. And I don't know if you, I'm applying for a grant to do this work that we're doing. And explaining to Ismail, who's clearly a very, very intelligent person, to walk him through exactly what you said, it was a bit of a revelation for him, so it should be made a bit more clear.
Maybe there is a way through, it's a limited analogy, but when your screen or when your app is in full screen, the menu disappears and then you're stuck with whatever you have to see. So maybe people can imagine this in 3D and then in VR. I don't know if it's sufficient, but I imagine most of us have already been stuck in the past in a full screen interface with actually no more interface. And like, how do we go back? Maybe that could give a sense of the problem.
That's a good point. I don't know if you can see, but I'm not recording a bit of this. Actually, look at that, guys. He is using an interface. He's got things on his hands. Do you remember that from Minority Report?
Yes, because sadly I have to see it, maybe not weekly, but often enough.
That's funny.
But I would add maybe a screenshot again, either from Foundation or the Gado or whatnot, just to show that. Because if you show the future as it was imagined 10 years ago, it looks a bit passé. So I would maybe add a couple of other newer ones. Maybe, I don't know what, like, super famous, I don't know, for that crowd, if that's the case, but like Avengers or Marvel stuff, they always have the...
What is the horrible Gal Gadot thing called again?
I don't remember.
The gloves were really just a security measure. The system could use hand recognition to tell exactly where his hands are, but only someone wearing the gloves is actually authorized to access the system. Yeah, that's it. We can retroactive continuity it in.
I'm so glad we have a lawyer here. I think you are dead right, Peter. That's funny and cool. Okay, let's see how this goes. That's okay, right? Is everybody there?
Yeah, nice. This looks better.
It should play automatically. Action. Format, movie. So this is the opposite. Okay, right. Mission Impossible. Yeah. What is this one you were talking about just now, Fabian?
I'll look it up and I'll send you the, if you, her last one, I imagine.
Heart of Stone?
Yes. It's somewhere in it. I have no idea. Yeah. Yes, they're selling notebooks, but
they still be using that interface. Just, oh god, that's awful.
I really do not
understand the appeal of this particular actress. Just, is this what you mean?
Yeah, it's in that. Well, there is that interface, but there are other ones like this.
What am I doing? Start new screen recording. Fine. Isn't it insane what tools we have to do this kind of stuff now? Oh, they have thing on it. They have writing. We don't need that.
It was another scene that I've been shown, which was when they were like, they have thousands of images as a kind of sphere around them, and then they can grab them, select them, manipulate them. There was no text in it. But
if you have a link, I'll use it. Anyone else can find it? Let's use the distributed FTL search capabilities.
I'll if it can wait tomorrow, I'll give it to you tomorrow, because I don't have it here. I would also, maybe for something a bit, I don't know if it's deeper, but more provocative, my position is more that I don't necessarily want the interface to be invisible, but I want it to be so efficient that I stay in flow. So the interface has to be efficient. Invisible, not necessarily, not to me.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm just saying that to be provocative. You know, it's kind of a joke, because I did hear a lot back in the day, invisible interface. Interface should get out of the way. It's like, no, come on. Oh, I have to show you something. Where is it? Oh, no. There it is. I also got this here in Italy, in Sicily. Can you see what it is?
Some stone.
It's a piece of obsidian. Mm. It's one of the earliest human tools. Cool, huh?
You're going to make
a very black
spears with them?
No, it was a carving tool. But, you know, it's just, you know, we're dealing with all this high-tech stuff. And, you know, like Fabian, you know, you have these things on your hand, and we talk about Alan's kind of paper things. These things kind of naturally, because of the way they curve, or because they're so high in silica, they really do fit the human hand.
It's still in my to-do list to do a workshop to make them, actually.
I believe that. That sounds very you. So which one should I use, guys?
I would use both if they were short enough, in the sense that the first one, everybody must recognize, even if it's to be triggered. The second one, just to show you, it's not a one-time thing. It's like in most science fiction piece, it's there. It can just be a screenshot. That's up to you.
All right. Since you insist. That's just, I think this one was a bit long, so let's just click on the movie, and we can click where to start right now. Okay, let's just see how it goes now. Oh, so it automatically went too quickly. That should be playing already. Yeah. All right. Okay. I'm very grateful for this. Any other thoughts or something? Finding spatial obsidian. That's interesting. Because, you know, in VR, everything has to be tracked, right? Your hands as well as other things. There's no reason why this obsidian shouldn't be an actual tool. That's kind of funky. Fabien, you have 1 week.
I mean, we can slice in 3D objects, so visible could be interesting.
Yeah, maybe we have to rediscover gathering in VR still.
Well, there is information hunting and gathering. By the way, I just got a message. Somebody in our community, Jeremy Helm, commented on the video version of what we're talking about. He says, "What about all the text we're already standing neck deep in? What's the mechanism by which the conflicted world all this language use has given rise to can reconcile and stand as background against which such new reality-bending workspaces are informed by this yet unfound continuity of latent wisdom?" Well, that was heavy.
Could you share the link of that in the chat?
Yeah. It's on the video itself.
Nevertheless, exciting. Exciting presentation. How much time will you get?
I think I have
40
minutes or so. So, you know, the funny thing is that the weekly calls we have 2 hours. And Alan's now going to be doing one on the whole recording at the same time, and maybe one on paper. And I was thinking maybe Fabian wants to host one of gaming. The 2 hours we have every week, if we have themes, of course it's great if we just go off piste sometimes, but if we also have a few themed one, invite the longer community, bigger community, I think that's really a good thing.
Fabien, did you want to say something?
Yes, that I think for the comment that was written on the video, I interpret this as basically trying to, could VR help to cope with information overload? Could we find a way to browse and bookmark and even consume or skim through information more efficiently? And I think, yes, as we explored also, especially in the group, is so far, at least the resolution is not sufficient for reading to be enjoyable in VR. It might not be the case for too long. Maybe it's already starting to be borderline enjoyable, but still, maybe it's due to habits. What might help more, or at least as much as higher resolution for browsing and then reading, would be more efficiently going back and forth between the different media, saying VR and Remarkable, or VR and the browser on the desktop, or I would argue in term of, in addition to, let's say, a nice interface to browse through information in VR, then going back and forth, it's probably where I would see the most potential.
Sorry, I kind of lost, like, is this, I lost the first part, like, this friction between, you know, going from Remarkable to headset. What about that? Were you suggesting it to talk about this or to have it discussed as a discussion point?
Yes, especially if you have answers, but I mostly meant that according to if the comment is the way I understand the comment for the video that was written recently was cool, but still too much information everywhere. Can VR really help with that? And in my opinion, VR should be able to help with that, both with higher screen resolution, but also, as importantly, being able to go back and forth more easily. Let's say if you pick a topic, video games, let's say, can you easily browse through Wikipedia articles in VR? And if you do, and if you make a little selection, can you easily go back on desktop and, okay, this I want to read, this I don't. And then the back and forth, in my opinion, is very lacking. Not necessarily because it's not technically possible, just because most people like use VR as a very isolated step. Let's say I do video game in VR and it has nothing to do with what I do on desktop. And the other around, I do stuff on desktop, nothing to do with what I do in VR. So I think the lack of connection between the two, to easily exchange annotation documents, set of documents, I think it's a limiting factor if VR were to be a way to cope with information over.
Yeah, so I have a small, it's interesting that you mentioned that because maybe I'm speculating now, but I find myself queuing certain types of content to certain devices. So I find myself, if I'm on my laptop and I see, let's say, a link on Twitter about some kind of WebXR or VR experience, then I basically copy paste that link to my, let's say, notebook, which I open usually on my VR headset, and I check it there. So I basically queue it there. And in a similar way, like if I see an interesting PDF or article, I don't read it on my laptop, but I queue it so that I can read it on my ebook or e-reader. And I can imagine, like, with this enormous amount of content being fired at us, even more in the future because of AI, I can really imagine that we will have to filter more and more to, yeah, sort of cue it to certain devices to check it out later instead of just mindlessly clicking and viewing everything once you're on your laptop or something. Well, it's great that everybody is currently thinking. I think now we're entering a different phase of this talk. By the way, are we finished with the presentation now? Should we go to something else, or should we? Do you still want to finish up other things, Frode?
Oh, I finished it a long time ago in terms of the conversation. I'm very grateful for any further comments on anything. I think it would be good if we go into different tangents. If you have something specific, absolutely.
I have a question, actually. Have you seen this foldable e-ink device? There is like a friend sent me, it was called, let me see, I don't know what it's called.
Is that a Samsung? Samsung or?
Yeah, maybe it's Samsung. Let me check.
So, while you search, I'll make a quick comment on this. Is actually, I noticed this during, especially on a holiday, when I'm stuck in commute for sadly a couple of hours. But when you have to get somewhere, you have to get somewhere. And I found that my happiness is usually correlated by how easily I can switch from one device to the another, not like one phone to another phone, but let's say e-ink to phone or a phone to a gaming console, because basically what I see and what I do on a different device is not the same. So it doesn't use, for example, when I read and when I play, like I don't do a lot of decision making when I'm reading the thing, maybe I annotate, but yeah. Whereas when I play, it's like decisions all the time. And I get some fatigue basically out of it. And I find that the ability to be able to switch from one type of device with its own type of content, because maybe I'm depleted out of either decision or focus when I have to read something hard, makes my travels a lot more enjoyable.
It's very interesting because, I think it's interesting because I'm starting to feel a bit overwhelmed by all these different devices, and they have all their different characteristics and advantages. And I really start to long more and more for a sort of a watch, universal watch later application. I found something like this. I posted it in the link, Joybox, which goes a bit into that direction. And I think not only do I want something like that more and more, I also want the app basically to tell me like, hey, this is something you might want to check out on your VR headset. Or no, maybe you should check this out on your laptop, because I guess at some point, as more devices are arriving, I would like a bit of guidance as well. It's quite overwhelming.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You know, like I talk about how wonderful this little watch is, but there's a lot of stuff that's useless on here. And there was something in the 90s where almost to watch this on a multimedia thing, do this, you know, that kind of stuff. But I think what you're saying is very interesting regarding that, having a more curated way of, you know, being suggested what medium makes sense.
Yeah, I would love to see a sort of map of like, this is what people use smartwatches for, and it like a Venn diagram or something of all these devices, because I don't really know why I should have a smartwatch until I buy one, probably.
In terms of queuing between devices, Pocket is pretty good. It's a startup. They got bought by Mozilla maybe even 5 years ago, a long time ago. So now it's by default in it. You have like a little Pocket add-on, I guess, and then you can send through. Sadly, because you don't have add-on on the browser for the Quest, you cannot like sync between the two. Might be feasible with a what's the name, the browser. Yeah, there might be an option to sync between the two, but basically you can use a Pocket to say, oh, read later, and then you can, I think, share across devices. So that might be a way, and there is an API. So the whole idea behind Pocket is read later. That's the one core feature.
So on your question, Leon, for my PhD now, one of the things I have to do is some basic analysis, statistic analysis. And actually, I'll show you. It's all relevant. So what I've done, okay, it's not even running. Okay, well, you know, I'm writing it up in this. This is the early stuff. So what I found is, based on the spreadsheet, that right, there we go. I asked a lot of people a question, do you use reference management? If so, I put it into here. This looks like it would be better or worse and all of that kind of stuff, right? But what was more fun and relevant is I decided to find out, of the people who use say they use Word, are they more or less likely to use a reference manager? So I took all this stuff, and here in the middle, I've sorted it now. So everything above this, they use Word. Everything they either don't or they don't say. So I found out that there is actually more people using reference management software of those who use Words rather than those who use something else. A bit of a surprise for me. But the point of that is, if you just look at this basic spreadsheet, it's a lot of stuff. And I'm doing means and standard deviations and all that stuff. What I think will be very useful, and this is me not wanting to do work, I want the system to do the work, is first of all, find a way to embed that whole spreadsheet in Visual Meta, no surprise, but then also embed it in a way that can be parsed. So it's robust, considering PDF is a bit of a mess. That's the first challenge, and considering it'll be over maybe different pages. Because then I would like to be able to write, as we talked about many times, computational text in the document. I want to have a sentence as in, I found out that people who were less likely to use Word, and then I write it in pseudocode. So I'll write something like, you know, take those who have this characteristic and sell this, that, you know, like how you use the spreadsheet, just write it out. And maybe we have a special symbol at the beginning of that sentence or not, I don't know. But I want the reader of this paper to be able to run that sentence on that included spreadsheet, right? This is something we've talked to many, many times in different, but now that I'm being lazy and I'd much rather have my examiners be able to do this, I can think it gets interesting, both with the pre-done sentences, and then they should be able to type in their own. And I can see there are reactions over, yeah.
So just to annoy you again, the way I do it would be in the browser, namely that if author and reader were, let's say, add-ons or ways to like code snippet that's added on pages, like having either iframes or ways to include content, I would know how to do it, and I would say, yeah, in terms of having a computational notebook, well, you add a code snippet and that's it. So I would, again, tend to flip it around with, as you know, my bias that I work in the browser, thus I think in the browser. But I think a lot of the constraints would be filled, matched, and then you could, yeah, have this kind of, let's say, rich content within it.
That's okay. But the thing is, you can always have rich content in a rich environment. But a rich environment doesn't necessarily last. Just think of Flash and other things. You know, early HTML interpretations, right?
Sure.
Because in a way, first of all, I do agree with you. A lot should be done on the web. So let's not polarize each other unnecessarily. But then at the same time, it's almost like you say the web is a magical place. Put the things in the web and you get the results out. You're still going to have...
I did not say the web. But I said the browser. But the browser can open pages or content that are on your desktop or laptop. It can be local. It doesn't have to be remote. So the argument in terms of preserving the data does not apply. If the browser disappears, then I think civilization is done for, but that's a different question. I cannot imagine not having a browser, but yeah, it doesn't have to be on the web. It can be, but it doesn't have.
Okay, I appreciate that. I think there is something more to that. But the thing is, okay, so obviously I'm very narrow-minded in this. I do believe that hiding data is a bad idea if the data is important and should last forever. And in an HTML page, the data is hidden because who sees the HTML page? I'm okay, the browser sees it. Okay, you know what? Let's not even worry about the different. Let's not rehash this argument because we know there are many pros and cons. Let's just continue with the notion of stuff is there so we can do these things, right? Yeah, Leon, please.
Yeah, so maybe you can help me answer this question. I'm wondering why is there always this separation between spreadsheets and documents, let's say the normal written documents? Like, why after the Lotus 1-2-3, Microsoft Word, Excel, why did, for example, this open this LibreOffice, what was it, OpenOffice or Open something like that? Like, why did they still continue the separations between having a spreadsheet format and a Word? Like, I don't really understand why that has never become consolidated into one format where you can have, let's say, a spreadsheet snippet which is native to the format, so it's not a link to a spreadsheet or to some other file. Like, I'm really, the more often you bring up this topic, the more I'm really starting to wonder, why did they continue this separation forever so far?
I can't answer it definitively, but I do have some knowledge on it, and that is, of course, the further back you go, the more integrated things were. Sketchpad was, of course, just one thing. Oh, yeah, Peter, good to see you. I probably won't be able to have a meeting next week because it'll be the conference, but we'll stay in email touch. Right, so I do believe it is partly cultural, partly commercial, because also Alan Kay's logo thing was not logo, but what's it, Scratch, you know, that was also about integrating. Apple had a project called OpenDoc, which went through a lot of things that became interesting, where you had a document and the tools will go into the document. You could have any kind of tool in the document. I talked to Don Norman around that time. It was really, really exciting. And I asked him, what tools do you expect to ship with as the default tools? And he just said, oh, that's for marketing to decide. And that instant, I realized the project was doomed. That just made absolutely no sense to me. You know, it's the same reason that Ted Nelson has had problems. You do something in isolation, you don't do it in the user's flow, it's not going to make sense. But honestly, and Fabian and Leon, please comment further. It seems to be mostly commercial. You know, that's how it works, and that's how it's become. And that is what we have to fight tooth and nail for now, not to have the case to be in VR. This is what frightens me. I mean, in Doug's demo from 1968, he writes a shopping list, turns it into a map. The map, of course, is just lines, but each item on the line refers to a location. So it's actually a map. You can click on that, and it'll show you the correct items in his shopping list. That was possible for a while on the web with easy for end users to make image maps and a few things like that, but yeah, I think it's absolutely crazy. This is why, of course, I have the map in Author. I'm trying to fight back, but I'm not exactly going to do a spreadsheet. Over.
Interesting. So perhaps it just boils down to a very unsophisticated separation to have multiple products, basically, instead of... and is this also, I'm suddenly reminded about HyperCard. Was that also an example of a more integrated thing, or was there no spreadsheet possibility in HyperCard?
The history of HyperCards is absolutely mind-boggling. First of all, I don't know if Bill Atkinson knew much about Doug or Ted. I don't know if he knew much about that. However, it was called Wildcard for a long time, up until a few weeks before release. The reason it changed name to HyperCard was that hypertexts gained prominence in around 1987 with the first hypertext conference and so on. So that was in the water in Silicon Valley, so to speak, as a name. But what I do know is that HyperCard was developed as a way for Apple to show that their computers were not just 2D desktop publishing devices, That is, of course, how they made their success, by making these machines that could do paper well. They needed to show a differentiation. So that's why Bill, after an acid trip, quite literally, decided, why don't we do these linked cards that can talk to each other?
Quick remark also, that it's something I had in mind during the presentation, and now that you mentioned HyperCard and links, it's something that I thought, especially for that audience, but which, I mean, whom you know better than I do, might appreciate more. Like, I did not see a lot of links or transclusion or whatever ways during your presentation, and I feel that might be... that might trigger some people. They might think, okay, some people might think, okay, interesting, but what's the relevance with hypertext? Maybe I missed it. Maybe it's not explicit enough. Maybe for that audience, it's okay. I don't know.
It's a fair point, but hang on. There's a thing. I just sent it to Mark Anderson yesterday, so I'll find it here. I'll share it with the group. Oh, there it is already. Stop. It's called... I'm going to try to upload as quick as I can. Yeah, call it this thing. So it's a little... well, actually, you'll see it in a second. Please tell me when you have it.
Yeah, I can see a table.
The difference between being a scientist and an academic. So, of course, the problem, the root problem, is that to become a scientist, you first have to be an academic. Right? You have to have your academic credentials. You can't do not well.
Okay, so I'm shaking my head because I did not know how I would bring that up, but now that's the time, I guess. During the holiday, I made a little notebook. And in that little notebook, there are some photos and there is some text. Mm-hmm. And the idea stems from this research center in Paris, where they did this thing called the Saventurier. It's a mix of savant and adventurer. And the idea is to bring a researcher, an actual researcher, to the classroom so that kids know what research is. And kids like 12 or something like this, not 18 or 21. And the idea is, research is the process where you have observation, hypothesis, all that. And why do I... got triggered and interrupted you rudely is because they are saying, yes, you can be an academic, yes, you can be a researcher in a formal setting, but the essence of it, the actual thing, is the process. So you can be in academia and you can have your grants and you can still not actually do research if, for example, you already know what the answer to the question is from the beginning, just because you want to make sure that you're going to get it. So I would argue that if kids can be proper researchers because they do have both a genuine question and a process, then yeah, I don't think you need to be in academia to do proper research.
However, first of all, to answer your question about the lack of links, I have added the word spatial hypertext to one of the slides now, just to shoehorn some of it in there. So thank you for that prodding. We were up on Mount Etna today. My clever young son asked questions that I had no idea about, which of course is much more exciting than asking a question when I have an answer. So I do agree that instilling the sense of proper research and being a proper scientist based on actually trying to understand rather than just blah, blah, blah is really important, no question. But if you want to have a job as a scientist, you need a degree. And the only way to get a degree is through academia. No one is going to hire you to do biochemical engineering based on your curiosity. You have to have a demonstrable skill set. And what you get from academia in the good set sense that I'm really suffering and learning now is you prove your ability to show up every day, so to speak. You prove your ability to be able to go through research and present it in specified manner. You prove your ability to write in the language of your field. So these are really boring things. Of course they are. But if someone is an absolute tremendous genius on Oppenheimer level, to use a topical name, you may be able to skip those steps. But for anyone in science to take you seriously, you know, if you haven't published anything, you have to be serious, serious, serious intellect. You have to find another way to prove it. You know, for absolutely the vast majority of scientists, got to have your academic credentials first. You know, think from a government perspective. If the government is going to have scientists to research something important, they need a way to judge them. Who knows what? Not just someone who has a good ability to think and talk, right? It's really annoying. I am not at all championing this. I'm just stating it as a serious impediment. I am not an academic. Doing a PhD has taught me that above anything else it's taught me. Leon, please interrupt me because I'm going all over the place.
Yeah, I kind of agree. I think that there's also a lot of academic/scientists who are a bit of both. Like they do their academic stuff, but let's say in the evening, many times I see that a lot of scientists and academics, they do things or important things outside of the, let's say, the daily work. Sometimes they even publish papers outside of the academic channels. So I think there is a sort of, I agree with the fact that it also saves a lot of time that you don't have to vet a person because you can see, oh, he has these academic achievements. That it saves a lot of time. But I find it very interesting that a lot of groundbreaking stuff, for example, the LK99 stuff, or maybe I'm wrong about it, but sometimes that happens a bit outside of the official academic challenges. Oh, no, for example, no, sorry, it was a Japanese economic professor. He sometimes publishes through the university and sometimes just he posts a PDF on internet. And because he doesn't really like to do certain things through these channels. And yeah, I think it's a bit of both. And there is not really an easy solution to unify both of them.
Yeah, and you know, yeah, Fabian, I see your hand. But the thing is, what I'm trying to do with you guys is exactly this. Right, I think we all agree on this. I mean, for instance, okay, so Alan Laidlaw, he has his credentials through work. I don't know his other credentials, and I certainly don't care. But in this community, his things of philosophers and stuff I have never thought about. You know, we value that, we as a community. There have been other people, have been nice people who've come into this community and not really been part of the whole, the way that I say, you know, literally expanding our skulls. They have a sales point. Whether it's a product or an idea, it doesn't matter, but they bang on about one thing. They may not fit so well. So it's really important to have these improvement communities, as Doug would call it, and to find ways to network them. So the grant that I'm trying to get now through my friends, if we get that, a significant part of that is to support exactly what we're doing now. And by getting this grant and by being able to publish at a higher level, it means that we are getting credentials without the academic side of it. So I'm not endorsing this cartoon table, but I am saying that for most cases, that's what it is. Okay, Fabian, jump.
Yes, I understand and agree. I think that's also the cost of the interface. Let's say you have to format the discourse in order to fit the boxes so that they can be ticked, and then you have access to resources. It just shouldn't lose the core, the essence of the adventure. A little tease, let's say. First, like I have this behind under the aventurier. It's a comics on Darwin's adventure. So in terms of the history of the scientific process and change of worldviews, I thought that was quite interesting. And now just before I go, the little gadget you might have seen in the notebook, I took photos. So I bought a camera and that's the Fuji. It's not a high quality one, but it has that slot so that I can print. So when I'm somewhere, and why do I say it's a little tease, because I really have to go, is because then I can do augmented reality without the headset. Let's say I do something, either good or bad, and then I print it and I put it literally on or next to the thing, because yeah, you don't always want or have a headset. So I think as a, I think there is something to explore there. But I must go. I apologize, but I will hopefully see you next week.
No, that's fine. 1.5 hours was good, but I'll stay with you, Leon, for another couple of minutes. Fabian, good to see you. I'll see if we can have something next week. I'll figure out the schedule. Anyway, see you very soon. Glad you're back.
My pleasure. Thanks again for everything. Take care.
Bye.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask one more question to you, because I can imagine at this hypertext conference, there might be a category of people as well, which might ask a particular type of question. And I get this question too sometimes, like we are talking about AI and VR and XR. For us, it seems very natural that there is a real connection between what text is doing to us and what it will hopefully do there as well. However, the moment when I say, for example, hyperlink, and I talk to and I talk about XR fragments, which is VR stuff, using text, but immediately it can trigger people's mind into thinking, hey, but this is not, what has this got to do with hypertext? Are you reframing hypertext now to sell some kind of VR story here? So I'm really curious, like if somebody is not getting this after your talk and you get this question of like, hey, are you now reframing hypertext into some kind of virtual reality metaverse area? Like how fast can you sort of like educate them into and seeing the relationship between text and where we're going?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I mean, I don't care about hypertext at all. I really don't. I think it's a dangerous categorization. That's why I like Doug Engelbart's notion of symbol manipulation. But, you know, I have been invited to do this talk. My actual presentation at the normal hypertext thing is just a demo of the software. But in addition, the human workshop have asked me to do this keynote. So, yeah, exactly. In the comments there. So,
yeah, it's a note to myself.
Yeah.
So does everybody necessarily agree with this term symbol navigation? Hypertext is basically symbol navigation. Do you think this audience will swallow that, or is it a hardcore hypertext audience?
A lot of the papers are just not that interesting. What happened with the hypertext community in 1987, that was the big first conference. Lots of excitement. And then a few years later, the web happened, of course. And then it became a bit, oh, what do we do now? Hypertext is real. It has been decided what it is. There is an article called Feral Hypertext. You know, it's wild. It's out of the lab. Discussing that. But then also a lot of innovation just died away, I think. And it was all about the web. After a few years of that, it was all about the social web, social media. So that's why in both the web conferences and the social media conferences are bigger. But even here, there is a lot of things of, you know, measuring user activity on hate speech in Twitter and that kind of stuff. There is a lot of it. There isn't that many people dealing with, here's text, what can we do with it, you know, in a hypertext thing. Because hypertext by TED is just basically connected literature. So I, you know, this thing, since it's an invited keynote, I think I have the right to go into more questioning mode. And I think maybe I should, hang on, let me look. Maybe I add the question, you know, what is hypertext in VR? That's. I'll actually write it straight in.
Yeah, I also remember a lady who joined one of our video calls. She, like, when, the first time when I joined you guys,
mm-hmm.
she also asked, oh, she said, I don't know if people at the hypertext conference will agree with your definition of hyperlinks, because it was basically, you know, connecting spatial experiences and not text. And that's when I got a bit of this feeling that there, that maybe she came from a more like, or she was indicating that it might be a bit sensitive, this hyperlink. But I think, yeah, I think the way how you describe it and also the history of these other events, yeah, then it makes total sense to connect this to VR, and yeah, definitely.
Was she an older or younger lady? Just to see if I can remember who it was.
Yeah, I think I have the talk on xrfragment.org. Let me see.
It was either Andrea or maybe Barbara Tversky.
I will copy paste a picture. Ah, yeah, it was this lady. I will copy paste it now. Maybe she will be there as well. Select the region. Second. Oh, wait. I will just share my screen because.
I'm just adding your question, so I'm not looking right now. 1 second, just making sure I have a. Okay, now I can see you. Oh, Deanie.
So this lady below Brendel.
Yeah, that's Deanie Grigar. She will be there. She's a close friend. And she's very much about the history. She's kind of a gallery, digital gallery and archivist person, also interested in digital literature. Those are the kinds of questions she would ask. I know she's on the same page with this, but... yeah, we'll see.
Okay.
I managed to shoehorn the text.
Exciting.
Yeah, but when I've added the question, what is hypertext in VR in here? So I'm very grateful for that prompt. And
thank you very much for the symbol. Thank you very much for the symbol symbol manipulation. I really love this term.
Yeah, it's beautiful, right? I completely agree. That was... You know, the first product I made was called HyperWords, which was a plugin for web browsers and for WordPress, where you could select text, get a little dot point to it, and do commands. And I decided I just liked that term. So Ted Nelson was okay with it, provided it meant something specific. And it was Doug who helped me discuss the whole thing of, you know, what is this? Is the fact that it's text what matters? What about numbers? What about maths? What about other things? We're talking about symbols that have fantastic grammatical attributes. It's not just like hieroglyphics, you know, which are different kind of symbols. So I'm glad you also appreciate that.
Yeah, is there some archive.org page of this hyperword? Because it really sounds like a cool idea.
It still kind of exists. It isn't running now. There is, I think I have some old videos of it or something, but it turned into...
Maybe for the next time.
Yeah, I mean, it turned into... I'll show you what it turned into. It turned into this tool called Liquid, which works on basically any page. Any page, whether it's web page or not. You select any text and you do keyboard shortcut and you get this. So it's copy the text into it. So now I could instantly do, let's say, reference Wikipedia for reptile. See, it's R and then W. So in normal use, it would look like this.
That's very nice.
Thank you. It's very quick. So if I want to search for an image, SI search image. We also have now built-in AI, obviously, because that's fashionable. So we do A for ask AI, and then we could do, let's say, A for list all main points. Of course, it's too slow now. You might as well read the thing yourself, but here it is.
Wow, this is really a superpower under your fingertips, especially with these shortcuts.
I agree. When it doesn't work on my system, and it's really hard to sell to people because it's really hard for people to get it until they try it. But, you know, like Stephen Fry, are you familiar with Stephen Fry, the actor and writer?
Yeah.
So he said this.
Huh. That's amazing.
But unfortunately, it's a Mac product. Maybe you should make it for Linux if you can. I would absolutely love for you to do your own implementation.
Yeah, I was thinking of it could be, do you know Bookmarklets?
Yeah, that's very, I don't know who came first, HyperWords or that, but it was the same kind of time. And yes, it's very similar, absolutely. I think we used it somehow as well.
I would really love this to have some kind of context menu, just like you showed, also in VR, and which would be the same everywhere on every device that you can, and which maybe shows different tools depending on the device. Very nice.
Yeah, I mean, that is what I'm working. By the way, here's the logo. Look at that. You see the H on the W? The idea for that was it should be a symbol like Planck's constant. You know, these are active words. So that was kind of the joke. But, you know, now it's all a bit different. Yeah, what you're talking about, I completely think is something to fight for and openness to that level. And I'm going to write that in here now. I'll add a slide. Actually, I'll share the screen since you were the prompt for this. I'm going to duplicate this slide, make this like one.
Yeah. I was also thinking like it's very hard to convince people of a solution of a problem they don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
They might say, oh, it's perfectly fine for me to surf to type Wikipedia and then search for the term. But I also noticed that sometimes that's a bit of a defense reaction for sort of feeling stupid when being confronted with a very smart solution. And it's not easy to sell a new way of doing things.
Yes, absolutely. I laugh because I agree with you. So this is based the big things here. These two sentences. I'll remove that.
Yeah, this is great because it also prevents you from being put in a corner, like, and get questions like, "Oh, so you really think it will replace everything?" This will prevent that.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, I'll clean these up, and I'm very glad we have these discussions too. Actually, no, I need this. This is going to be the where the attendees can
find the slides.
Yeah. No.
The questions. Oh yeah.
This.
Ah, yeah.
But for now, I'm making this the master list.
Oh, maybe you have to cherry pick some questions with the audience because there is enough to discuss.
Yeah, it's too many. Absolutely. Too many. So yeah, I'll work on that.
All right. Oh, we have Bramble joining.
Hi, sorry, everybody. I broke most of my toenail off last night, and so I was wrapping up.
Randall, I don't want to hear that.
Ouch.
That's horrible.
Yeah, it's not super painful, but I'm loading up on all of the over-the-counter things that I can to make sure that it stays that way and I can keep responsible. But the main thing is just that it's probably going to take like 6 months to get better. So,
that's...
Do you have to keep up your leg now all the time?
I think mostly just for the bleeding. And it didn't bleed much. It was pretty clean.
Okay.
Anyway, sorry. You were presenting your hypertext presentation. Yeah,
we've gone through a few things, but I would be very happy to run through it with you if you don't mind. Because your perspective is very worthwhile in this context. Shall I go ahead, Brandel? And Leon, do you mind going through it again?
It's fine, yeah.
Okay. Thanks, because we've made quite a few changes. I've been very grateful. Yeah, so the presentation is called Where Are We With This? And with this, of course, I mean VR, and specifically interactions with knowledge, and by VR I mean all kinds of fully immersive environments, AR, VR, etc. And I want to make it clear, I don't think we're all going to be working in VR all the time, but they can become thinking caps if we're careful with what we build in terms of tools, infrastructures, and maybe most importantly, people's expectations. So a question is, will VR constrain us or free us? I'm not here with answers, but I'm hoping we can come up with better questions together. This is a call to arms to think about thought and multiple dimensions of freedom. So what happens when we no longer need a substrate, a medium for interaction? This was the end goal of HCI, right? The invisible interface. We just added this, Brandel, during this talk. I may edit this video down a bit. Impossible? Yes, of course it's impossible. But what happens when the substrate almost disappears? Do interactions get easier? No, not necessarily. If we think of things like dancing, sports, these are activities with very little interaction with anything other than our own bodies, and they tend to be harder. With VR, this is where we're going, potentially. So we can ask questions such as this, and these questions will be made available at the end of this presentation for us to discuss. Plus, there will be a Google Docs with them. When we can reinvent tools in this entirely new environment, which tools will be useful and how will we define tool? These are questions we need to ask in conjunction with what kind of environment we want to work in, since it's all synthetic. What environments will we be working in? Early VR was fully immersive. And then Apple comes along with spatial computing, where you default in AR and you have windows, volumes, and spaces. Is this how we want to work? We as a community need to think about this, because if we don't know, we cannot legitimately complain. Also, a question is this a necessary step of training wheels for full VR? And Brenda, look at the lady in the middle. See? So cool. Or is it retarding deeper dreaming of what VR can be? I hold human imagination to be one of the most powerful faculties we possess, something to be cherished and nurtured, not to be put in boxes. How else can we navigate to a better future if we cannot dream it? Opportunities are wide open. Let us not prematurely constrain them. Let us proactively dream of powerfully interactive knowledge worlds. I'm beginning to think I have too many of these statements now, but anyway, for now they are here. These images were all created by generative AI based on the Apple Vision person illustration you saw a while ago. I prefer dragons to boxes. So will AR multiplied by VR be more powerful than our imagination? That's an entirely different and new dimension, not what I will address here today. But let's look at what is it that we see in VR. Cannot easily separate environment from tool anymore, information from tool anymore, or information from interaction anymore. What are the affordances and what are the expected affordances? Text in VR? Yes, of course. Text is symbol manipulation, and in VR, it's symbol manipulation at scale. Going from Dungeons and Dragons to documents and dragons and documents of knowledge interactions. It's a bit of a joke that Fabienne almost made me put in, but I decided to do it anyway. So a document in VR, I open it, it looks good, I gesture and things move about. So then we start looking at questions of what is a wall? Is it something that's a rectangle or is it something semantically defined? Of course, Brandel, these are the questions we talked about for the last year. Can I call my wall a graph wall and another my pictures wall? What software owns it? What is it positioned in relation to my head, desk, room? What is the space? How do we move between spaces? What tools will work where? And what tools will you be able to take with you? This came up with discussions of like control menus and things like this. How do we transfer information? Lots of questions. You know these questions already. So a gesture to the wall and the graphs are there, and graphs without text are not all that useful. You can think of this as spatial hypertext in VR. I had forgotten to use the word hypertext until the discussion today. So a knowledge graph in VR, it's amazing. I can think and work at room scale. However, even at desktop or laptop scale, it can get messy and overwhelming. A key is selection control and view control. Control is the ability to act. Oh, that shouldn't animate again. Sorry about that. I will fix it right now. Nothing. Do not do nothing. Yeah, act, react, connect, and undo. So an illustration from the map view and author. I select something. I use a contextual menu to define it, specify it as being an infrastructure, then go to the map view. And Brandel, I hope to have the contextual menu for this as well to show how these commands are done. Otherwise, it's a bit opaque. So I select all the metadata so I can move them. I do that by hiding and bringing them back. That's why they blink. So then I can use standard word processing keyboard shortcuts for how to change the layouts, what they're aligned to, and all of that stuff. Select all the names in the document and do vertical spacing, and then I align them right-edged. They're a bit off the screen, pull them in. So this allows me to have free-form movement without having the clutter of everything selected. But I can still do things individually. move them in whatever size of unit that I want. And the point of that is, it is great to have direct interaction, but we'll also need more powerful means to select and organize. That's the one thing I'm trying to fix with Author right now. So then a question becomes, where will the equivalent of a context menu be in VR? Gestures, menus, rest menus. So here is one by Fabienne and another one for novel ways of accessing your opportunities. And also, will they remain wild for long or become standardized like command keys on the Mac? So in closing, told you this wasn't a very long one. For me, the goal of VR is to create an environment where my brain can breathe. That phrase comes from talking with you guys over the years, particularly the last few weeks, where I realized that being in an environment where you don't always agree, very often disagree, it can be very frustrating, can be fun. But the point is, we share a common direction. So someone like Alan can talk about paper, and I go, what? But it is all within this. It makes my skull bigger. And I think this kind of environment that we have built here is what software environments should at least aspire to make your head feel not smarter, but bigger, more opportunities and peace. So VR extends our potential. How we choose to extend ourselves defines who we are. And who we want to be. This is, of course, my son, Edgar, as you know. How we define interactions in VR now will determine interactions for generations, just like PC interactions became standardized with word processing, email, web, spreadsheets, and not much more. Oh, sorry, I was editing that last bit a lot. I did a double image. So I just remind the audience, this has been a call to arms to think about thoughts in multiple dimensions of freedom. And here's the list of questions and the Google Docs for it.
This is awesome. I really like it.
Thank you very much.
I think it sort of sets up where there are some fundamental questions. The one thing that I'm curious about is whether the audience will accept the premise that VR has the slightest relevance to hypertext off the bat, because you have some screenshots of sort of functional sort of productivity and tech-centric VR earlier. So my thought is, if you can have some shots of soft space and some other things that have a legitimate and really crystal clear representation, like this really can be used for that. This is not just for being a badass, but there is legitimate value. You know what I mean?
I completely agree with you.
So unfortunately, even a good couple of bits of soft space. I also think, I mean, I really love Maxime. I talk about this stuff where so much. Maxime Cordiel's work with immersive access. It's not hypertext, but it is sort of intensely multi-dimensional data. And I think that hopefully it's relatively clear that data manipulation of that kind has relevance both to productivity, and that it's not a huge stretch to take that from productivity into text to hypertextual productivity. So that's Maxime Cordiel's Emaxi's work. But I don't know how you want to introduce it, where you want to put it, but that's the only thing, is just leading early with some of those things to be like, yes, it does this. It also does this. And this is why we have these important questions.
Yeah, no, I think that's very important. So,
But other than that, I think that with that, like, all you need is something to sell those people. And then I think I'm really on board with everything else that it's doing and the way that it's doing it.
Let me see how to present that. Uh, Maybe I should something like this. Hang on. That's not what I wanted to do.
Perhaps a little brief.
Perhaps a touch. Yeah, I'm wondering also, Leon, if you are still there, the kind of the bridging of this, because you've really helped with some of the bridging today. What do you think?
This is slide 9. Okay. This is real now. And this is the soft space, or?
Yes. Whom I would say is part of our community. He has presented, and we need more input from him, obviously.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I also think that like the map one is pretty good. Did it get toward it at the end of that clip? I don't know how long it is.
I can play it properly.
I think it looks like it starts to create the tree down in the bottom left.
You're right.
But I'm not sure how long.
It starts.
I see. So it's not super long.
This is where we should start, right? Here, I think.
I think so. Yeah. I think that looks. Because it's just a slightly more sophisticated manipulation of that stuff rather than just tearing things out, which is important, but less obviously. So if you don't have the ability to impart that kind of structure. I just got CC'd on an email to Craig Federighi and Craig Joswiak and Dan Riccio. It's terrifying.
Yeah, I can imagine. What does it say? Oh, well, I guess you can't tell us.
You know the process too well.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Okay, so I should probably credit him.
And you don't want to pose the question in between, like, what does this have to do with hypertext or something? That you literally, or you want
to? Oh, yeah, no, this
slowly...
is
perfect. Yeah, I like that.
This is perfect. Yeah, just what you said there. Hang on. Ta-da! Right.
Oh. Yeah. Nice. I'm going to drop in a couple of minutes with my work day begins, but I think that works.
You were late, you know, but I'm very glad you're here. So we're staying over just for you. I was wondering also, Brandel, if you want to have a 30-second pre-recorded thing for me to slot in here, because you actually know what you're talking about. It could give this whole thing a bit of gravitas. It may be just by doing this, you have, by just mentioning this, done that. I don't know what you feel.
I will think about it. I had a great talk with an outgoing intern on Friday, I guess, Thursday, Friday, where I kind of characterized my stance as being an anti-realist, which is probably a little, like, where I'm just not concerned with the presentation or reproduction of reality per se, but just with the presentation of multi-dimensional sort of input and output channels, such that like reality is our best set of priors for what those should be like, but it should only be taken as sort of a starting point for the way we actually want to control for information in future, because there's so much more to do than just wallow in reality. But that's probably a little out there for this time.
Hmm. Okay, that was deep.
I can unpack it another time, but yeah.
Yeah. So what's the chance, Brandel? You said it's not a huge chance for you to come to Future of Text this year, right?
I don't think it's super likely. I mean, I could look at paying for myself and going, but I need to look at what else is happening. I've got a couple of demos. I got one big demo of my own this week and then one in a couple of weeks.
Oh, interesting.
They're just sort of the periodic sort of presentations of points of view about how new things could work. Just what my day job is, but yeah, good to be able to pay attention around those moments to make sure that I can get all the work in that is necessary to make it look awesome. But I will think about it, and I will definitely take the time off to be able to join remote in whatever capacity I can around it, even if I can't be there in the flesh.
Yeah, obviously, I hope you can make it. I was just talking to Leon. He's trying to organize making it. And as I can say to both of you, if we do have space, you are very welcome to stay with us, obviously. That's
something. Thank you.
Yeah, no, Leon, if you are there, that also very much goes for you. I just don't know what the reality is quite yet of that time.
Yeah.
Because then we could keep talking.
Totally. Yeah, the one challenging thing as well is that while Vision Pro has been announced, it has not been released. And so it's a pretty sensitive time to have a lot to say about it. It will be different next year. unfortunately, yeah, like it's still weird because people think that everything can be discussed, and to the extent that everything can be discussed about iOS and things like that, and that is not currently the case. Cool. I'm really glad to have seen this and caught the end. Sorry for my lateness, but my toe demanded that I sort of take it easy and sleep in.
that's fine. Leon, I see you having.
Yeah. I have one more question to Brendel. Like with this anti-realist, were you sort of talking about that it would be very disappointing to replicate everything in our physical world into VR so that we would have to basically have a copy and have to do the things in exactly the same way as we do things in reality? Is that a bit what you mean, that would be a bit disappointing?
Yeah, well, the other thing about it is that our capacity to attend to things is not uniform. So, for example, we can read text pretty well because we've hijacked a part of the brain that was used for sort of visual contrast in that way. But we also have an even larger part of the brain called the fusiform face region. And so if you try to make faces that are real, it's just dizzyingly difficult in comparison to making chocolate bars that are real. I don't have a chocolate bar in front of me, but maybe I wish I did. And the problem with that is that, like, yeah, sure, it's useful to be able to make faces, but it becomes that much more difficult because of our capacity to attend to it, that, like, we can do other useful stuff with it without getting mired in these other sort of unnecessarily difficult problems to get to some utility based on the sort of practicality of the medium. So I love having full hand tracking as exists on Quest and Vision Pro. And I think that that's really important. I think that it's not necessary to go for realistic physics, for example, if you can get other things out of other things. Because I also think that the more problems you can solve, the more effectively budget you can get for all things as well. And so the way to get enthusiasm, the way to get something to develop is just to solve problems for it. You know, like the VR winter was caused because latency and processing and delay and all of that kind of stuff was bad. And it wasn't, VR didn't solve it. VR just piggybacked on mobile phones. Smartphones solved that piece of the problem. and got the sort of the state of the art over the line to the point where people could actually use them, use that other sort of technology. And hopefully by 2016 or so, people were excited enough about what was going on there that they were able to start actually solving problems and getting kind of money. It's partly a position, pragmatic perspective based on what gets expenditure and interest is sustained capacity to do real jobs for people. And those real jobs just don't need to be related to the reproduction of reality per se.
I totally agree. I also think that a lot of the VR winter was focused around the idea of growing an audience, that people using VR should be part of some kind of big audience, and that triggered like the need for avatars, which I for example, have never ever been interested in my avatars, to be honest. So it's very interesting how the many angles different people have to sort of evolve VR. It's not easy.
Yeah, and it's fascinating to sort of play games with people or to understand that what they desire out of digital platforms is so wildly divergent. I've just finished that book on the immersive enclosure, the history of virtual reality in Japan. It does a really good job of describing the history of virtual reality in the West as well. But one of the things that it sort of characterizes is that like Japan VR in Japan is substantially like given over to giving people an escape as an identity escape as well as a space escape. And so people very much want to be things, and they can be things other than what they are, which is for the most part wanting to be pretty schoolgirl apparently. But it's just like, that's not, I don't think I've ever considered what I am in VR anywhere other than in Half-Life Alyx when I was obliged to simply because she talks. But everywhere else, I don't see myself at all. So it was really interesting to hear that that was such a sort of an overarching and underpinning kind of theme through it all.
There is, I do have a comment on that. And that's my family in Japan, because we Emily has two cousins, and they're identical. Identical, right? Yeah. One of them lives in Tokyo with his own family, kids, and so on. The other one lives with his parents. The one who lives with his parents is obsessed with camping, as in going up into the mountain, finding a house with insufficient ventilation and burning a fire. And, you know, they're both really similar people, but I think that what drives the camping, this is my perspective, he hasn't commented specifically on it, but we enjoyed this in Easter, is living with his gosh darn parents all the time. So for them to have their own identity, that's where they go. And we went to Emuji, or what was Emuji? Yeah, Emuji, massive store with the family. And there was a huge section on camping. And I think part of it is Japanese people don't have extended holidays very much, so they can't travel very far. But I also think it is the family generations living together creates a need to define yourself, to have your own space. So VR slots beautifully into that.
Yeah.
So I guess that's an example and maybe a good thing to end on, that what happens in VR really is a reflection or an opposition to what happens in the real world. McLuhan would have loved. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So I'm not sure if we can do anything Monday week, because it's the actual hypertext thing. And the program is still a little bit confusing on that day. Mm. But if we can meet, I'd love to talk to you after this stuff. And Brandel, if you want to do a 30-second or a minute, not giving the Apple official perspective, but if you want to give the face of Apple as not just being, here's product, buy it, you can watch TV, you should feel free to do so. because but it depends on what you think is right.
Yeah, cool.
Fantastic. Very grateful for today. I wish you could all be here in Sicily. It's amazing. The first few days we stayed in a hostel, and just Africans working there, except for one white woman. And now we moved to a hotel with a pool, not a hotel, a bed and breakfast with a pool further inland. But I really liked the place where we were. It has almost like a straw roof, this bar by the beach. So the light is really good. They make the most excellent iced coffees. So I go back there in the morning every day, even though we don't stay there anymore. And I ask them, you know, what the place is. And it turns out it's a reception place for refugees. So all these guys are from Africa, except for the white woman who's from Ukraine. At the beginning of the war, the whole place was flooded with Ukrainians. And the guy in the reception, who's so much like the guy in Emily in Paris, same loft, same amazing, beautiful style, he is from Gambia. He came here as an unaccompanied minor. Was now managed to get a job there. So I'm mentioning it partly because of the human reality, but also the actual space where I sit and work in the morning is probably what most VR headsets want you to feel like when you're in it. It is that kind of paradise. Maybe next time we'll have a Future of Text in a paradise. Maybe next year. All right. Have a good week. Thank you, guys. Bye for today.
Cheers. Bye.